Welcome to the Explainer. Today, we're going to tackle a question that seems, well, kind of weird when you first think about it. Why do countries buy things they could very easily just make for themselves? Let's break down the logic behind it all. So let's get right into it. It's a real head-scratcher, isn't it? I mean, you've got these wealthy, super productive countries. They can make almost anything they want. So why on earth are they buying stuff from other places? Why not just be totally self-sufficient? Well, the answer is actually, believe it or not, really clever. The whole secret, the real key to understanding this, isn't about being the strongest or the best at making everything. Nope, it's a much smarter concept, and it's called comparative advantage. Honestly, this idea is what makes the entire global economy tick.
Okay, so what in the world is opportunity cost? This is a huge idea in economics, but it's actually pretty simple. All it means is that to get one thing, you have to give up something else, right? Every single decision you make has a cost, not just in cash, but in the other things you could have done with that time or money.
And this is where most people get it a little mixed up. We tend to think trade is all about who's the absolute best, who can produce the most stuff. That's called absolute advantage. But that's not what really matters. The real game changer, the thing that truly drives trade, is about being more efficient. It's about who gives up the least to make something. And that is comparative advantage.
Okay, that's the theory. But it can feel a little abstract, right? So let's make this real. We're going to look at a classic example that really shows how this plays out. All right, check this out. We've got two countries, Israel and Jordan. In a month, one worker in Israel can make 10 high-tech units or 6 agriculture units. Over in Jordan, a worker can make 3 high-tech units or, you guessed it, the same 6 agriculture units. So you can see right away, Israel is way more productive in high-tech, and they're tied in agriculture. So on the surface, why would they even bother trading?
This is where the light bulb goes on. We have to figure out the opportunity cost. Look at Israel. To make 10 high-tech units, they give up 6 agriculture units. So for every 1 high-tech unit, the cost is just 0.6 agriculture units. Now look at Jordan. To get just 3 high-tech units, they also have to give up 6 agriculture units. That means each high-tech unit costs them a full 2 agriculture units. So it is way, way cheaper for Israel to make high-tech stuff, not cheaper in dollars, but cheaper in terms of lost farm output.
And bam. There it is. Israel's opportunity cost for high tech is super low, so they have the comparative advantage in high tech. And if that's true, then automatically Jordan must have the comparative advantage in the other thing, agriculture. So it makes total sense for Israel to go all in on high tech, for Jordan to focus on agriculture, and for them to just trade with each other.
This quote really just nails it, doesn't it? Yeah, Israel can grow its own food and do it well, but it makes so much more sense to use those brilliant workers and resources to make high-tech products where they have that massive advantage. They specialize, they trade, and everybody ends up better off. It's a win-win.
Okay, so specializing is step one. But that's only part of the story. Just because you have an advantage doesn't guarantee a deal will actually be made. There's one more piece to this puzzle.
For trade to actually happen, it has to be a good deal for both sides. It's got to be a win-win. And that all comes down to finding a fair price. Now, fair isn't just some random number. It has to be in a very specific sweet spot. And that spot is determined by, you guessed it, the opportunity costs we were just talking about. So let's figure out how to find that price. We're going to use another quick example to see exactly where that sweet spot for trade actually is. All right, imagine two places. Let's call them Economy A and Economy B. For A to produce 1 ton of oranges, they have to give up making 4 tons of grapefruits. But for B to make that same ton of oranges, wow, they have to give up a massive 16 tons of grapefruits. So it's a no-brainer, right? Economy A is way more efficient at making oranges. They have the comparative advantage.
Okay, put yourself in Economy A's shoes. You're the one selling the oranges. It costs you 4 tons of grapefruits to make them. So if you're going to trade, you're not going to accept anything less than 4 tons of grapefruits, right? Otherwise, what's the point? You'd just make the grapefruits yourself.
Now flip over to Economy B. You're the buyer. To make your own oranges, it costs you 16 tons of grapefruits. So you're only going to buy them from someone else if the price is less than 16 tons. Anything under that is a great deal for you.
And right there, that's the magic. The fair price zone is anything between 4 and 16 grapefruits. Let's say they agree on a price of, I don't know, 10 tons of grapefruits for 1 ton of oranges. Economy A is thrilled. They only needed 4 but got 10. And Economy B is also thrilled. They would have paid 16 but only paid 10. That's the win-win.
So when you boil all of this down, the entire logic of why countries trade comes down to just two really basic rules. Rule number one, figure out your comparative advantage. Do the thing you're most efficient at, the thing with the lowest opportunity cost. And rule number two, agree on a price that's somewhere in between both of your opportunity costs. You do those two things, and trade makes both sides richer. It literally creates wealth out of thin air. So, if the economic logic is so simple and so clear, why is global trade such a hot-button issue? Why is it so controversial all the time? Well, that's because we've been living in the nice, clean world of economic models. The real world, it's a lot messier. This logic doesn't factor in things like people losing their jobs in a specific industry, or national security, or just plain old politics. And that, my friends, is where things get really, really complicated.